everyone. My name is Mohammad Ahsan Khan and welcome to all of you, The Wifi Show. Tonight, our guest is not an ordinary person. In fact, he is an inspiration for his students globally and also a role model for young teachers. Ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce you, the legendary Sir Hasan Dosani. Welcome to the show, sir.
Thank you, Ahsan. Thank you very much. It is an honor to be here.
Sir, first of all, I just want to congratulate you for the SBL result of March 2021. How it feels to be so much popular among your students globally?
So I've been teaching for last 20 years and I'm very humbled that, over the last 20 years, I've taught over 5,000 students.
That's great.
So now what's happening now, which I never realized in the past, that wherever I go, 50% there's a chance that I may bump into a student who I never knew. But people will walk up to me and they will greet me and then they will remind me that they have been my student. Now they have their own kids. They are like CFOs. They are finance managers. So really, thanks to God, thanks to Allah, that it is very, very rewarding. I'm very, very humbled that now students whom I have taught like 15, 20 years back, they are really excelling in their professional career, in their family life. So nothing is more, gratifying to a teacher to see, the students progressing. Really, I have no words to express my feelings.
Well, that's a reality, and we all know that your charming personality and also your extraordinary teaching styles makes you all-rounder in the fields. But I just want to know today, our viewers want to know today, that what is the secret ingredient that they find in your teaching that the students globally want to enroll in your class, that they want only SBL from Sir Hasan Dosani? What is the special ingredient?
I think nobody has asked me that question
before
so far. So I think first and foremost is passion. Like 20 years back when I started my teaching career, and oh, by the way, I'm not a full-time teacher. I am a working professional. So I'm a CFO.
But that's
been a CFO for last 12 years now. So teaching is something which I do on the side.
As a passion.
So initially it started 20 years back as some pocket money for me.
Okay.
But slowly and gradually as I built into it, I discovered that it was my passion. So I think that the first and foremost thing in any teacher, it's not about me or SBL, any teacher who would like to connect with the student, number one is passion. Number two, I think in my case, I try to make the subject extremely easy for the student. So I have lots of knowledge, but it doesn't mean that I translate all the knowledge to the student, because the student's objective is to pass the paper. The student is not there to do a PhD in any subject,
exactly,
right?
Exactly, exactly.
They can do PhD later on, right?
But at
to come down to student's level is something which I feel adds to my secret recipe of connecting with the students. And obviously, I try to make the subject more interactive. I try to share my real life experiences, because I sit in the boardrooms, which really helps me give real life examples to SBL students, because SBL is all about boardroom. And because I sit in the boardroom as finance directors, I know what's going on inside. So these are my three main as I would say CSF, critical success factors of connecting with students.
Okay, if I remind all these three points for our viewers, that if you want to achieve anything, either it's related to your professional life or your personal life, the passion is important. So I think it is also an advice for your students who are watching you right now globally, that whatever you do, just do it with your full passion, because excellence comes with the passion. It's not comes from the part you are playing and again and again. It's not it's not a race. You have to cut yourself from the race. So sir, following this passion thing, I just want to ask you one question. This is a perception of our society that those who are only good in numbers and figures, number game, so they should go for the accountancy professions like CA, ACCA, ICMA. There are so many accountancy professions. Question is it really important for a person that if he or she is the good in numbers, then he should go for the accountancy field? Accountancy field is only about number game, or we should also have the other qualitative quantities as well?
A short answer is accountancy is not only about number games. It starts with numbers. But you know, in numbers are actually extremely important in any business. Forget about accounting or reporting or auditing. Numbers, so you might be surprised that when we grow senior within an organization, all the directors, all the department heads have to be good in numbers.
Okay, that's a one part of the thing.
Right, so it doesn't matter whether he's a CEO or he's a marketing guy or he's a HR guy or an engineer looking at the production process.
Exactly.
All the senior, the top team of the company has to be good in numbers. So to say that numbers are not important is not correct. Okay, that's why all these people, they do MBAs in finance so that they understand numbers, because at the end of the day, everything boils down to numbers.
Numbers, exactly.
But when we talk about accounting and numbers, yes, numbers are very important because we are the drivers. We help the board understand the numbers.
Okay.
Right? We tell them what this means and how we can take decisions. But technical aspects like IFRS or all those extremely technical things, you know, they are maybe important or relevant for the first 5 to 10 years of your accounting career.
Yes.
Right? So to say that numbers are very important for to be an accountant, yes and no. Basic business acumen has to be there. It doesn't matter you are an accountant or you are an engineer. But very technical accounting information is very short term. So I wouldn't agree with your or society's perception that people with numbers should choose accounting. People with business acumen, commercial, mindset, accounting will be very, very interesting and fun-loving for those people as well.
Okay, sir. You are absolutely right that the numbers is not only the thing that gives you high in your professional life. So what about the other features of a person, the other features of a personality development? That we all know that the chartered accountants, ACCA, they all are already good in numbers. That's why they are working on the very good positions, on the strategic level positions, CFO, CEO, as you told earlier. So, but what about the communication skills? It is very important. I strongly believe that a person, he belongs to any field, he should be good with the people as well, because at one day, if you are not good with your communications, then how you can communicate your, decisions to the upper level and also to the lower level management. So it's a complete hierarchy. So what is the importance of communication in your point of view?
Communication is extremely important. The more you grow up the hierarchy, your technical skills tends to, gets a smaller weightage, and your soft skills includes communication skills, persuasive skills, argumenting skills, emotional intelligence, those growing. Most of the time, the CEO, will look to the CFO to take his view. And again, most of the time, the CFO disagrees with other directors because he knows the complete picture. So in order to put his or her viewpoint across, so the communication skill is extremely important, because we think numbers, we are technical people, but the listener, the other side of the audience, are not accountants. So we may think or analyze in a technical or a professional mindset, but when we talk to them, we have to talk in a layman language, convincing. So communication skills, I cannot, you know, stress more on that. So, and, you know, ACCA realized this thing, that communication skills and commercial skills and all these things are important ingredient of an accountant's personality. So that is why when they launched SBL, they actually, you know, included professional marks for communication skills, for business acumen skills, for analysis, evaluation, skepticism. So there are five professional marks areas in SBL. So this is the whole background of introducing so much professional skill marks in SBL, because they realize that accountants lack communications and commercial acumen skills. So it's really good that if we do SBL, it will, you know, give a good solid foundation for your future communication skills and you know, or commercial skills. So very, very important.
Okay, sir. This is understood, and I think that is pretty clarified for our viewers as well, that your communications, your personality development is also important if you are only a number guy. So don't be a quantitative person, also a qualitative person. So sir, as you told me earlier, that SBL helps the students to achieve their, you can say, financial aspects of the business, sir. But I just also want to know that what is the most important part of the SBL in student development? The why ACCA include this course, SBL, in this qualification, sir? What is the most important part?
Yes, very good question, Asan. As we grow in finance, so you're a finance, you will first become a a finance officer, and then you will become a finance manager, and then maybe a CFO. So the more you grow, the more your expertise are required on the business side. Your accounting expertise are not required. For example, financial reporting, all those things will be taken care of by your juniors.
Okay.
Yeah. You know, in my job, since last 10 years, 70% of my time goes into budgets, financial planning, variance analysis, proposals, projects, you know, projections, decision making. Now, in order to, you know, make a proper feasibility of anything, you need to understand the business.
That's right? Very important.
So SBL talks about all aspects of the business. It talks about strategies, it talks about marketing, it will teach you about HR, IT, online, change management, project management, so many things, leadership, governance. So it actually makes you an all-rounder from a business perspective.
It's a complete package, if you can say that. You as a accountancy student, you also have a communication, strong communications,
yes,
and also a strategic business decision power, which SBL taught to the students. So I think that's very pretty good that
that's
this course is playing.
Good, but unfortunately, I would like to share the flip side, that ACCA's all the remaining other subjects, like 13 subjects, they are hardcore accounting subjects.
Okay.
Financial accounting, financial reporting, audits, all those things.
Yeah.
So the 13 subjects are, you know, programming or brainwashing a student to become an accountant.
Accountant.
Right. And then suddenly this SBL pops up, which talks about business. They don't want an accountant, they want a person who understands business. So the main reason why not all, but most of the students, they fail SBL is because they continue thinking like an accountant when they are attempting SBL paper. So the biggest challenge I face as a SBL teacher is to change the mindset of that student for those 4 hours. I want them to think like a business. And I can confirm to you that each and every student does have a commercial acumen. In today's day and time, the digital era, everybody is street smart. They understand business. But because they are programmed like an accountant for like 13 subjects, so they find it difficult to change hats. So, but yes, SBL, I think, will create a foundation for you. It may not be useful for you or for any student for the first few years of the career, but as you grow, suddenly you will forget about IFRS and you will start applying SBL thinking. Yes, so it will be a transition.
I think if I sum up this thing, your point of view, your expert opinion, that SBL is the subject that creates balance in the accountancy, professional student.
Absolutely.
That you should also be good with the numbers and also good with your colleagues, your communications, and the most important, your business acumen, the strategic business decision making. Because we are living in the 21st century. Business, it's not about the numbers only now. It's about doing collaborations, mergers, and these all big decisions need your strong communications and the strategic thinking. So I think, sir, this is very comprehensive and a very satisfactory answer for our viewers. I hope you get your answer. Let's talk about the COVID.
COVID, okay.
Yeah. COVID, the most important question, sir. As we know that from 2020, this pandemic situation impact our society globally very badly. So, sir, I just want to ask you that it also give big bad impact on our education sector globally, and also especially to the Asian countries as well. Most of the institutes are becoming habitual to convert their education system on online, digital, virtual learning. So, sir, do you really think that is it possible to convert the whole education sector just rapidly on online virtual studies? Is it possible?
Yes and no.
Yes and no.
For elementary education, I would say maybe no. Physical education is important for schools and, you know, Montessori's and schools. But for professional education, I think it is possible to, do your learning through online technologies. Having said that, there are pros and cons for everything in life. So where there are big benefits of online education, there are certain drawbacks as well. But then for physical education, there are certain advantages and there are certain disadvantages. What COVID did was it exposed the limitations of a physical education system.
Exactly.
Okay. And even now, like 15, 16 months down the line, still education sectors are unable to operate at the same level as they used to do. Talk about India. There are phases of COVID. Talk about other countries in the world.
Yeah, very bad situation. I hope it will be good soon, inshallah.
Yes, for professional skills, professional level education, online is a very good option. Mainly because we have to be, as a student, you guys have to be very comfortable with technology. It's now or never, because the moment you will step into your professional life, the moment you will get a job, it's all about technology.
Exactly.
You will be given a PC or a laptop on the day one. You will have your own email account. There are companies, systems, softwares. Everything is digital when you enter a company. Yes, you do go to an office, but your work is on a keyboard and a mouse.
Yeah, everyday work. We see this.
Right.
Everyone is
so,
doing online.
Our office is paperless. We don't have any papers. It's our global strategy that we will go paperless. So everything is digital, scanned, on the phone, on the laptop. So if you adopt technology now for your education, it will give you a head start. You know, if you are reluctant to adopt online education now, and then suddenly you enter a company for a job and everything is digital, you will just fall flat on your face. So my recommendations is that if you can adopt online, this is the right time, number one. Number two, you will get access to extremely good teachers if you adopt online learning technologies. So I have so many students from the African continent, and they are from such remote areas. So I've got a student from Iraq, I've got one student from Yemen. These are war zones, and yet students are trying to pursue their professional education. So had it not been for the online things, they would never have done that. So you will get access to good teachers. Good teachers may be available in some main cities of the country, but people living in remote areas or unable to commute because of COVID, through online, they can have access to the best teachers of any subject in the world. Okay. However, the flip side of online is that now it will not work for students who are not self-disciplined.
Okay, I have one question to add over here.
Okay.
And I know that most of the viewers, most of the students who can see me now, they are slightly angry with me. And the question is that you talk about the positive side of the digital learning. But sir, we all know that there are some also developing countries, like Asian countries, where we have three different classes, middle class, upper middle class, elite class, and also the underprivileged class. So sir, the students who belongs to the lower class, they also have a eager to complete their professional education. But digitalization is not a game for everyone, if I am not wrong, because first of all, the price that you have to purchase very smart and expensive equipments like laptops, smartphones, internet modems. So I think it's a very costly thing for some of the students, not for all. So how what is your advice, and how you think that we as a society can come up with this issue and solve the problem of these students? Is it really necessary to complete the whole education on online basis? Because there's also something which is lacked in this part, like your physical appearance. If you are not physically present in the class with your teacher, then your concentration, your focus is lacking. Most of the students who are taking their class on Zoom and different online apps, at the same time with taking the class, they're also doing their other part of the work, their personal work. So don't you think this thing also declines the quality of the education that a student is right now taking?
Yes, as I mentioned in the start, there are always pros and cons. So in today's day and time, almost everybody does have a PC or a smartphone and internet connectivity. So I knew, like I had few students from Africa who were from a very poor country. Only one of them had a PC. The other two didn't have a PC. So they used to come go to his house and they used to, you know, watch the videos together on that one PC. So now it differs from case to case.
It's very, yeah, I understand.
But there are certain limitations of online. So each individual needs to, you know, analyze the specific circumstances for individual basis to see what options they have. Do they have access to good teachers? Do they have access to internet? Because, you know, ACCA exams are also online now. And if today they are not completely online, maybe after 12 months down the line, they will be all CBE papers. So even, you know, the professional education, the exam bodies, professional bodies are now converting into online exams. It's just a matter of time. Okay. So whether we like it or we don't like it, maybe COVID has accelerated the conversion from physical to online, but it's just a matter of time.
So I think we should take it as a challenge as well.
It's that, an opportunity, I would say.
As well. When we talk about the threats of online education, I think we should deal that these threats as an opportunity, because I strongly believe that if you go and push your limits, then you achieve more.
Absolutely. And maybe the first 12 months of COVID was a challenge. I have no doubt.
Yeah.
Because it was sudden. Nobody was prepared. The corporates were not prepared. The people were not prepared. Now I think enough of the challenge.
But now we have
time. Now we have time to think. Now we have time to, you know, replan our strategies and our way forward. So now we should take this as an opportunity. Enough of challenge now. We have to make our plans, you know, make it work for us for the next 3 years. Everybody needs to change their plans. You just can't keep on deferring your exams, 6 months and another 6 months. This will go on. COVID is not going to leave, I think, pretty soon.
I think it's a new normal.
It's the new normal.
We are talking about.
So
it's a new normal. We have to live with this.
So it's a good opportunity now. Enough about challenges. We need to rethink.
Well, sir, it's a very motivating statement from you, and I hope the viewers agree with you. Just take it as a challenge. We don't have any other option. Just develop ourselves. Okay, sir, according to a survey, there are 5 million students, if I talk about the Pakistan, 5 million students who are not going to school, who are not going to the college or the university. So, sir, this is a very big number. I know it's not a very actual number, but according to a research, it is. So, sir, in this current situation, in this current, you can say, pandemic situation, what role ACC is playing? I know it's a very tough question and a very... And I hope you have an answer for this.
ACC cannot play a direct role because... If unfortunately of so many people are away from the education system, then it is a problem of the society. So it is the role of the government and the society to make sure that they fund, make sure that the, you know, children who are outside the schooling system, directly, indirectly, they come into the education system.
But it's playing its good role in for the professional students.
Definitely, yes. As part of their CSR strategy as well.
If you go through their
annual reports, they do have a very heavy budget for these kind of sponsorships and, you know, scholarships and all those things. Yes, they have a very strict criteria, but, you know, they do encourage students from underprivileged strata of the society, yes, to come up.
So they are coming up with the help of ACC,
yes,
and completing their professional accountancy qualification.
And there are many cases in the many examples in the past as well.
Okay, sir, it's clear that ACC is playing its part very well. So now what about WIFI, Virtual Institute for Higher Education? As we all know that the CEO of this institute, Sir Rizwan Mania, has been playing its part for providing virtual online education, especially to the accountancy students. So I just want to know, you have a very old and strong collaboration with WIFI. So in your success, what is the important part of Sir Rizwan Mania as a CEO of this institute and the WIFI? How WIFI is providing education, professional education to the professional students? How it becomes a reason of change in the society, sir? What is the value addition of the WIFI in our educational sector, sir?
Right. So, as you know, that WIFI is a 100% online educator.
Yes.
It is not like any other school or college which offer both options. And it's there for like almost 4 years or 5 years. So it specializes. Yeah, exactly. It specializes as a digital online training provider. All right.
All right.
So when COVID came, I think Wifi already was at in the digital space.
I think Wifi is the pioneer of providing digital virtual learning.
Yeah, in Pakistan.
Before
ACCS,
COVID,
yes.
In COVID, and it's still providing.
Yeah. So, technology-wise speaking, Wifi is much ahead of other schools and colleges, because other schools and colleges, they were focusing more on physical with online as a byproduct. But Wifi's 100% focus was just online.
So we can
say
that.
Technology-wise, Wifi is much ahead, much superior than others. So in the pandemic, while others were trying to adopt technology, Wifi was already, you know, thinking three steps ahead. So I think Wifi does play an important role. And other than the technology side, Sir Rizwan, he likes to focus on the academic side. So, you know, having mocks and having assessments, having teacher assistants who are interacting a lot with the students on a day-to-day basis.
Exactly.
Arranging free webinars. I believe some
webinars
are about to start. I'm not
they
sure.
They are coming soon from 10th of May. Be ready, guys.
10th of May?
Yeah.
All subjects?
Not all subjects, but
core subjects?
Yeah, core subjects like SBR and other courses as well. You will get the details.
So, so this is how Wifi is trying to add value by offering free webinars. And I think these free webinars are getting quite popular because they are very exam focused, very comprehensive. So yes, I think instead of struggling with technology, now Wifi is actually, you know, done with technology. They are now focusing more on how to deliver quality academic aspects of the product, not the technology side. So
if I conclude this thing, that for our viewers, for the students who are already enrolled with Wifi, that Sir Rizwan Mania, Wifi plus technology and innovation provides you the best quality online education. And we all know about this. This is a reality. There is nothing you can say, any speciality in this thing, but it's a complete reality. So, sir, now let's move on to our hot seat question. The most important question of this session for that. I just ask you that recently, ACCA announced that the June 2021 examinations will be CBE. My question is this the decision that most of the students are looking for, or the authorities should reconsider it?
Are you talking about Pakistan specifically or globally?
No, let's talk about Pakistan first, then global.
Based on the feedbacks I got from several students, like 40% of the students are extremely disappointed that ACCA is now going towards remote CBE. Okay, the CBE was always there, but it was a center-based CBE. So like in March it was manual. And then, I'm talking about professional papers in Pakistan.
Papers.
In March, it was manual. March was the last attempt of manual paper in Pakistan. And from June, it was CBE, but in a center.
Okay.
So when you are doing a CBE in a center, challenges like internet connectivity,
again, the
and
issues
electricity,
arises.
And the proctor not, you know, helping you, you know, so those are addressed. Those are now the problems of ACCA or the managing body. But now they've cancelled that, and now they've gone for remote CBE, which means that each student will give the paper from their home, from their personal laptop, using their personal internet and personal electricity.
I think it's a very big step taken by the ACCA. So guys,
it was done in September.
Okay.
It was a failure because there were lots of teething issues because that was the first time post-COVID.
First time is always
so. I understand. But then, so now I'll talk specifically about SBL.
Okay.
So SBL, guys and girls, I would definitely support CBE because of the nature of my paper. I don't know about other papers. I'm not commenting about other papers. But for SBL, I would strongly push for CBE. Okay, because it becomes easier, faster, you can copy paste stuff and then you can, you know, present it nicely. When you do a manual paper, you know, it's a 4-hour paper, so you will exhaust while writing so much stuff.
I think we should give the time to the viewers to note down these tips from Sir Hasan Dosani.
So CBE is definitely preferred in SBL, and in my personal opinion, internet and electricity is a smaller issue. Okay, it's a rare issue, especially in Pakistan. I don't think so that we are now right now using technology, right? We are live using internet. I'm on my WhatsApp all the time. So internet is not an issue. The issue here is the actual CBE software. The CBE software, it crashes when so many students, they give paper at the same time across the world. In the last 3 attempts, I have got few complaints from the students that either the functionalities were not working or the software got hanged and the paper was submitted 45 minutes before. So there are serious issues with the software, and that software is not in our control. So my word of caution is that although I would prefer CBE, but I have some doubts because of the past track that the software is not up to the mark. There are few instances. So you guys should think. Forget about internet and all those things.
Get yourself ready, what he wants to tell you.
Yeah, so you just, think. It all depends how prepared you are. If you are prepared nicely for SBL, then don't miss this attempt. Then go forward and take a chance. What will happen? If the software malfunctions, you can immediately apply for mitigation circumstances. And they will, cancel your paper and carry forward your fees to the next attempt.
Okay, that's a very important thing. Just remind it, guys.
So I'll just repeat it. So case the testing software, if there's any problem with the testing software, then your exam will be suspended. Your fees will be carried forward to next attempt. Yes, you would lose 3 months. Yes, you would lose that hard work you did for the last few months, but at least from a financial point of view,
you will
are
be safe.
Not exposed.
You will be safe.
Yes. But students who are not well prepared and they've never used the CBE, the shock factor is big for them.
Exactly.
Only like 3 weeks or 4 weeks are left. So I don't think they will be able to cope up with the shock factor in the 4 weeks. So for students who are lukewarm, they are 50% prepared for the exam, they may consider pushing it off to
September.
But those students who are confident, they have done the subject once or twice, so you should not worry. You go ahead with full confidence. If something goes wrong with the software, you apply for the mitigation circumstances through your MyACCA portal and your fees will be suspended and carried forward to your next attempt.
Well, sir, it's a very good thing. So now I can sum up this thing. I know the challenges are here. There are so many threats related to your technological side of our country and the globally. But I think it's also an opportunity for you. Just take it as an opportunity and also develop yourself. Take the risk. Okay? The ACC is with you. And also your faculties are with you. So be prepared. It's never too late. So, sir, it's all about, we talked about the pandemic conditions and the role of WIFI and also ACCA, and also you provide the guidance to your students globally. Now, I just want to know that in 2020, when the COVID started, our job market was on the peak, but when it started, suddenly the graph was going down, and still it is down. So, sir, according to your experience, your 20 years or plus experience, what do you think that what's coming next? The students who are getting cleared will be getting cleared in June attempt. So, what will be the market opportunity for them is waiting?
That's a very difficult question.
That's why I ask you, sir.
What is the future of job market given the background of COVID? So, you know, we, and when I sit in the boardrooms, we are not able to arrive at a conclusion. Situation is so fluid, it's changing, it's so dynamic, so it's changing, it's different from country to country, from sector to sector. So I don't have a straight answer.
So you can say that
the job market is not good. It doesn't look good at the moment, because
we cannot predict it.
Yeah, a lot of big corporations gone bankrupt. A lot of people lost their jobs, and now, you know, companies are rethinking about their business models. Companies like Facebook and Google, they are completely revamping the business model. So the trend which I can see is, yes, there are challenges, but then wherever there are challenges, there are opportunities
as well,
right?
Yeah.
You just need to keep your eyes open for that small window and equip yourself with that skill set to, you know, get a chance through that window. So, for example, a lot of organizations are now encouraging work from home strategy. Okay, especially these big organizations, 5,000 staff, 10,000 staff, and 70% of the staff is from the back office, like operations and finance and IT and audit and admin. So now, in order to become lean and mean and cut down the fixed cost, people are now thinking of allowing remote working. Okay, now when companies in Europe and America are thinking of remote working, then now the second question is why they should hire people from America and Europe. Those are expensive resources. So if the employee needs to work from home, they can might as well be in India or Brazil.
Any country.
Or from any country or Philippines. Because it doesn't matter which country you are if you're working from home, right?
You just need an expert person for the right job.
Exactly. So it's now the technology which these companies are able to afford. So now they are shifting their focuses on low-cost countries. So like companies are shifting their back-office functions to low-cost countries like India, like Vietnam, Bangladesh, Pakistan, Philippines. So that's an opportunity. That's not a good news for European market or American market, but that's a big good news for third world countries.
For the developing countries.
Yes, for the that's the right word. For the developing countries, because we are cheap, and because companies are now pushing for remote working, they are looking to cut down their costs by 60, 70, 50%, 60%. So that's the only way they can reduce their fixed costs, right? So, concepts like freelancing and offshore service providing and all those things, you know, even audit firms, they have now, you know, they just have a small front office and a large auditing team sits somewhere in the cheap country. So, people who are in developing countries, you must acquire skill set. The first skill set is You must be friendly. You must be in love with technology. Because if you are working remotely, then technology should be your girlfriend or boyfriend. Do you understand?
I think this thing attracts the most.
I'm very serious. So. Technology and you should be like this. If now or never. Okay? So just adopt technology. It's not too late. And it's not too difficult.
It's never too late.
Acquire this skills. So it's not very complicated things I'm talking about. It's a basic technology aptitude. That's it. So if you have good technology aptitude, good communication skill, because you are sitting miles away, you need to be in contact with whoever. So your communication skill should be good, because it's different to communicate face to face versus communication through technology or video conferencing. It's different. So communication skills and technology should be good. So it doesn't really matter which city or which country
you belong to. If
the companies and corporations are looking for developing countries, and you're a good freelancer, or you work with a company who provides outsourcing support services, so there is an opportunity. Even our company, we are a Singapore-based company, and Singapore is very expensive.
Running your own company?
No. I work in an insurance, in a financial group called Philip Capital.
Okay, that's good.
And we are in 15 countries, but the head office is in Singapore. It's a family-owned Singapore business in 15 countries. So now, as a corporate strategy, we are thinking of pushing back our back office to cheaper countries.
Economies of skills, basically.
Definitely.
All the countries, either they belong to the European market or the Asian market, they want to achieve the economies of skills. Economies of skills is that you want to lower down your cost and want to increase your revenue. So people, I think that's a very good news for you, that develop yourself, join yourself with the technology, and then the innovation creates. And once the innovation is created in form of your words, in form of your skills, then it doesn't matter that what country, what society you belongs to. If you are the right person for the job, people will going to hire you, definitely. Okay, sir, thank you so much for your time and your opinions. I think it's a very good session to motivate your students globally. So, thanks for your
everything. I honestly look forward to these kind of sessions, because this platform gives me an opportunity to connect with students. And, these students, they need guidance. They need a mentor.
Counseling is very important.
Yes.
Counseling
is very important. Because I work in a corporate world, I'm so, looking forward to share my experience, my thoughts with students.
Help them to grow more.
Even if my thoughts can help even 1% of the students listening, it will give me immense pleasure. So thank you very much.
Thanks to you for inviting me
and arranging such sessions. And I just, the time is running up. I would have loved some. So next time, please do keep a question and answer session, because I would definitely want to reach out to students with specific problems. So maybe next time, in your format, keep some time for question and answers.
Exactly.
And I wish all of you students all the very best. And in case you want to get in touch with me, you can, get my WhatsApp number from Wifi. And we are all out there to guide you, help you, and support you.
Thank you so much, sir. So viewers, I hope you like this session, as this is our first Wifi show and the first season of first episode. There is more to come. So see you, stay tuned. We will see you in next episode.